Hello everyone and welcome back to Together in Worship. We hope you had a lovely Easter. It's still the Easter season, of course, in many churches. And so this week we will think about how Jesus appeared to the one or two, and also to many people at once.
Later on, I'll be talking about how perhaps we too experience the risen Jesus, even though we, unlike the disciples, haven't seen his hands and side in the upper room. We have some good songs, and a lovely song that will take us back to Good Friday for a moment, a beautiful rendition of Written in Red.
Let's begin our time together with a song that reminds us that Christ is alive. This was actually written as a response to the assassination of Martin Luther King, to remind a shocked world that even in dark times, Jesus lives. The truth is still reassuring today in our own generation.
That is a good song. It's filled with hope. We've noticed an increase in the numbers of people joining our Together in Worship, and we want to welcome you if you're new to our little fellowship. If you'd like to, please subscribe and click the little bell icon and you'll receive notification every time there's a new video.
There are people watching from all around the world. Many of you are perhaps alone or with a spouse or friend. We believe that we are indeed all together in this time of worship. We are focused on God, sharing his word, and joined by the Holy Spirit. Let's join in this old hymn, Jesus, where'er thy people meet.
Thank you.
Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this time we can spend together in worship today. You are worthy of our praise, and we lift our hearts to you just now in thanksgiving. In these moments, we want to open our hearts to your presence, taking time to know that you are near. We want to thank you for this last week, Lord, for your grace and your love, for walking with us, encouraging us. We thank you for your gifts for us, for the blessings that we know come from your hand. Forgive us for the times we have not walked with you in our thoughts, words, and actions. We confess to you our need of forgiveness, thanking you for your loving kindness and the promise of redemption. By your Spirit, renew us today that we might live more worthily of you. May this time of worship be a source of strength and a means of grace. Open our hearts to you and our ears to your word, that we might be blessed and our faith made strong. We pray in the name of your dear Son, our risen Saviour, Jesus. Amen.
Here's a Bible reading that gives us Paul's testimony about meeting the risen Jesus. Unlike the apostles, he never met Jesus in the upper room or on a beach. In fact, he was most definitely not a disciple. But Jesus came to him anyway, and Paul was, you could say, a surprised convert. This is Acts 26.
Why should any of you consider it incredible that God raises the dead? I too was convinced that I ought to do all that was possible to oppose the name of Jesus of Nazareth, and that is just what I did in Jerusalem. On the authority of the chief priests, I put many of the Lord's people in prison, and when they were put to death, I cast my vote against them. Many a time I went from one synagogue to another to have them punished, and I tried to force them to blaspheme. I was so obsessed with persecuting them that I even hunted them down in foreign cities. On one of these journeys, I was going to Damascus with the authority and commission of the chief priests. About noon, King Agrippa, as I was on the road, I saw a light from heaven brighter than the sun, blazing around me and my companions. We all fell to the ground, and I heard a voice saying to me in Aramaic, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? It is hard for you to kick against the goads." And then I asked, "Who are you, Lord?" "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. Now get up and stand on your feet. I have appeared to you to appoint you as a servant and as a witness of what you have seen and will see of me. I will rescue you from your own people and from the Gentiles. I am sending you to them to open their eyes and turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to God, so that they may receive forgiveness of sins and a place among those who are sanctified by faith in me."
We are so blessed to have beautiful songs that bless us. Here's a song that focuses on the death of Jesus. As the opening song reminds us, Jesus lives, though ever crucified. So here's written in red.
Oh,
At the end of our time together this week, we'll be singing, "You Ask Me How I Know He Lives, He Lives Within My Heart." Sadly, there are those people who might not accept that. So what can we say to friends, family and work colleagues who might say, "But how do you know?" I think we can reply with three words: evidence for the risen Jesus, an encounter with the risen Jesus, and our own experience of the risen Jesus. Of course, there's no proof of the resurrection, not the kind that the world wants anyway. We live in a sceptical age, and people express disbelief in nearly everything now, you name it. We remember that's been the attitude of the world since Doubting Thomas. But there is an argument, if I can use that word, that gives us some powerful evidence for believing in the risen Jesus. Because they believed. Because Thomas believed. Why would the disciples invent the story of the empty tomb? Why would frightened men, hiding themselves away for fear of the Jewish authorities, suddenly stand boldly in public, telling everyone that Jesus was alive? And why would they die a martyr's death, convinced they had seen the risen Jesus? That, to me, is evidence. It's a powerful case to make. They were so convinced that Jesus was risen, nothing would shake their belief. We can believe because they believed. St. Paul was once a sceptic. He went from house to house, dragging men and women to prison for believing in Jesus. But then he wrote this, 1 Corinthians chapter 15. "For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Peter and then to the 12. After that, he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers at the same time, most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. And last of all, he appeared to me also, as to one abnormally born." Now, we know about the apostles, but notice that there. 500 people. Who were these people whom Jesus appeared to, all at the same time? This is a whole crowd. And Paul is saying to the sceptics, listen, the resurrection is a historical fact. There's evidence. There are literally hundreds of people who can back me up here. We believe because they believed. We are convinced because they were convinced. And that's evidence. We also believe because of the encounters with the risen Jesus that people have had. We start with Paul, who wrote, "And last of all, he appeared to me also." Well, that's unexpected. He wasn't looking to believe in Jesus. He was against Jesus. But Jesus met him. Paul encountered the risen Christ. You could say he was an unwilling convert. It was certainly a surprising conversion. And throughout the centuries, there have been people who have surprised others by their encounter with the risen Jesus. Testimonies and changed lives have been powerful in bringing others to God. And like Paul, a lot of these encounters were unexpected. C.S. Lewis, who wrote about Narnia, was a highly intelligent man, but he totally rejected Christianity in his teens and was an atheist right past his 20s into his 30s. There was no way he would believe. But one of his friends was J.R.R. Tolkien, who wrote The Lord of the Rings, and he was a persuasive Christian. Lewis wrote this about the beginning of his belief in God. "You must picture me alone, feeling the steady, unrelenting approach of him whom I so earnestly desired not to meet. That which I greatly feared had at last come upon me. I gave in and admitted that God was God, and knelt and prayed, perhaps that night the most dejected and reluctant convert in all of England. Now that was just the first step. Later he made a full commitment to Jesus while on his way to the zoo of all places with his brother. And he wrote, "When we set out, I did not believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And when we reached the zoo, I did." Two famous encounters 2,000 years apart, and both remarkable because they were unplanned, unexpected. And so many encounter the risen Jesus unexpectedly, and that makes it genuine. Lastly, the skeptic cannot deny your experience. Now, you don't need anything dramatic. Your quiet testimony of meeting the risen Jesus is just as valid and just as meaningful as someone like Paul or C.S. Lewis or any others that you've heard. Yes, you believe because of what the Bible teaches. Yes, you might believe because of the testimony of others. But your experience is personal and powerful. I'm saddened when I hear atheists say that we should take religion out of public life. They think it's just an opinion that we have. But it's not just that. It's a relationship with Jesus, an experience of the heart. We meet the risen Jesus when he comes to us, however he comes to us, in the words of the Bible, in prayer. It may be through the words of a friend or that still small voice of God. It might be in worship, but it's always a personal experience of him, not just a belief, not just an opinion. You ask me how I know he lives? He lives within my heart. You might remember these words of Jesus to Thomas, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and have believed." How can we do that? Because he comes to the heart. The disciples saw his hands and his side. We don't, but we believe they did. Paul saw a vision of Jesus. C.S. Lewis became convinced in his mind Jesus was true. We may not have that kind of encounter, but we believe they did. The risen Jesus comes to us in different ways. We have different experiences. But he always asks us to believe. Paul writes, "If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved." That's the heart's experience, the inward assurance that Jesus is alive. You ask me how I know he lives? He lives not merely in my mind, but in my heart. Do we need proof? Do we need him to stand and show the nail prints like he did with Thomas? Do we need a blinding light like Paul? No. Just believe the word, receive him by faith, and then you will be able to say, "He lives within my heart." That's evidence enough for the skeptic. That's an encounter that nobody can dispute. That's an experience of Jesus that is yours forever.
Thank you.
Shall we pray together? We thank you, Lord Jesus, for the certainty we have that you are alive today, for the witness of Scripture, the faith of the disciples, and the countless people since who have experienced your living presence in their lives. Lord, we are part of that experience, knowing you, loving and serving you. We thank you that you sought and found us. You came to us in your risen presence, and now we can say that you live within our hearts. When our faith is low, when sometimes we doubt you, when opposition might come from others, help us, Lord, simply to trust in you. Walk with us each day, Lord. May your presence be a blessing for us, whatever we face each day. We think of those whom we love, our families and friends, people in our church, especially those who are ill or burdened. Draw near to them, walk with them in your risen power. Lord Jesus, help us to be confident that the future is in your hands, that we can rejoice because you are indeed alive in our hearts, in our church, and in our world today. Amen. Thank you for joining us again this week. We really hope it's been helpful to you. We'll see you next time on Together in Worship. May the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you all evermore. Amen.